Okay, so this is a paper that Renu Kasane and I wrote, and we got funding from NSC-IFF, which made this paper possible. I'm going to give a quick background. There is increasing evidence of mis-selling of retail financial products in the market. And as consumers, we all have anecdotal stories, but there is larger work out there which sort of puts it out in the academic space. Susan Renuka and I did a paper together where we estimated how much retail investors in India lost because of missold market-linked insurance plans over a seven-year period. And it was a huge $28 billion amount. The regulators have responded pretty much by pushing responsibility away from themselves, very similar to what we heard in the governance space, where they said that it will take better disclosures, more disclosures, and financial literacy to make markets safer. And what we felt, Renuka and I felt, that possibly when regulators mandate greater disclosures, we don't have enough evidence whether these are actually enforced, what kind of disclosures are made, and when the disclosures are made, are those actually accurate or not? We don't have enough evidence on that. So this paper starts to map out some of those questions. We are saying that what actually do distributors recommend? How do vendors behave when a naive person walks in versus whether the person who walks in who has a specific product that he wants to buy? When that sale is being described, what features of the product get actually disclosed? Do the more obvious features get disclosed, or is it some of the do tougher attributes of a product like cost and exit options get discussed, or is it really about returns only? How accurate are those disclosures? What drives these recommendations? Is it really just commissions? Is it incentives? Is it the way that the incentive structure is set up? So we decided to conduct an audit study through the banking channel. Why choose banks? Banks have become a very important part of the retail distribution in India, especially after the universal banks were set up. Banks are also trusted by account holders in India, and they also have access to a lot of financial information, which is why banks are well placed to make that sale, because they know how much money is in your account, and you go to the bank and you trust the person sitting across the counter. We also found that banks are actually fairly well regulated. There are all kinds of regulator requirements that banks who sell third-party financial products have to follow. So you have RBI, you have IRDA, the insurance regulator, which will mandate how insurance is sold. You have SEBI, which is the capital market regulator, mandating how mutual funds are sold. So it should be a well-regulated market, but that's what we set out to discover. So how do you actually map a private conversation? So when you go to buy a financial product, we know that it's a conversation between you and the person selling the product. Financial products are invisible. You can't kick the tire to see what it looks like. You walk away with a flawed understanding of the product. And when regulators mandate people to read those 30-page documents, it's a disservice because only lawyers can read the disclosure documents which are put out. So we set up the game, we set up the audit like this, that you have a customer who's looking for a tax-saving product. For the non-Indian audience here, middle-class India, the people who pay taxes, are used to doing a bullet investment around February or March every year, because that is the time that you get a tax break when you make investments in a certain set of products. So there are some 10 products into which, if you make an investment, you get a tax deduction. So it's fairly plausible for a person in February or March to walk into a bank branch to say, I'm looking for a tax-saving product. So that gave it authenticity. We did this study across two time periods. One is in March, which is when the sales push is the highest through banks and insurance companies, mutual funds, in selling these products, and people are also looking. And one we did in July, where we felt that that sales push is over, but let's see what happens once this is over. We audited 400 bank branches in Delhi. There are over 2,000 branches. We audited 400 of them, 200 in March and 200 in July. There were two sets of auditors. So the auditor, one set was a naive auditor who would go looking for some tax-saving product. He wasn't sure what. He would walk into the bank branch and say, I'm looking to save some tax. And we Renuka, Sani, and I did train some of the auditors, all of the auditors, to get them to have authenticity in the conversation where they could say that we've had a transfer from out of town or I don't like the current bank, which is why I'm here shopping for a bank. So one would go in and say that I want some tax-saving product. The other person who's the non-naive auditor is saying I want something called an ELSS, which is the equity-linked savings scheme. For the non-Indian participants here, it is a product which is recommended by fee for financial planners in India because of its transparency, low cost, and early exit options. And the returns in this product have been comparatively higher to other market-linked products. So the non-naive investor, the smart investor, is going to ask for an ELSS fund. He's walking in saying, I want to buy an ELSS because I want to save tax. We split the conversation into two groups. A person wanted to invest 25,000 rupees, and the other person wanted to invest 1 lakh or 100,000. The average ticket size for mutual funds and insurance is in the range of 50 to 60,000 per year. When we did this in March, the auditors were simply supposed to write down the disclosures made. Remember, we are trying to map the sales process. We are not trying to catch mis-selling per se. We are just trying to see what the process is. We are asking what happens when a person walks in. So in the first, in the March study, we said that you just write down the disclosures as they are made. Right? You're not asking any questions, you just write it down. In the second, in the July audit, we said you now will ask questions. You're not going to ask multiple questions, you're just going to ask, what does the product return? What does it cost? Are there any guarantees? Is there an early exit? Is there a cost to this early exit? And what is the optimal holding period? Now, in our mind, we thought that these are the fundamental attributes of a financial product. If the car doesn't have a steering wheel or wheels or a good seat, it's not a car. So in a financial product, what makes it a financial product? You must know answers to some of these questions. It was a double blind. The auditors did not know what they were trying to map. The bank managers, of course, were being audited. The auditors were not allowed to take notes inside the bank branch, but they could come out and they would fill the forms that we had given them. And we also had a little space for them to write their comments, you know, which was the non-sort of ticking of a box. And that's where a lot of qualitative information that we got came from there. It was really interesting to read some of the things that they had written. So then we come to the results. So the stage is set up, the auditors go out, and the results begin to come in. And the outline of the result is when the person walks in, did the manager ask the person what his financial goals are? Now remember, we are now hitting at a very deep regulatory confusion in India that is the person selling a distributor or an advisor? Okay, so that basic thing is unclear. So if he's a distributor and person says, can you suggest? He should say, I cannot suggest. But if he's an advisor, he cannot just vend the product, he has to do much more work. The first question would be, what do you want to do? Who are you? Are you married? Kids do you have? What other financial products do you have? So he should ask like 25 questions. So there is ambiguity as to the role of the relationship manager who's selling the product. Is he a distributor or an advisor? Did the manager distribute the requested product was the second question. What got recommended? Was the recommendation accompanied by disclosures? Were these disclosures correct? What drove these disclosures? So we found that a large number of the bank managers did ask for the overall goals. Why are you investing? Is it for retirement? What do you want to do? Private sector banks were a little better. I forgot to tell that. Sorry, we did a mix of the public sector banks and the private sector banks. We found that you couldn't get into the door with the foreign banks like Citi, HSBC, because the requirement was to have an account with them. So you pretty much cannot mystery shop a foreign bank in India, but the private sector and public sector banks were open to letting a walk-in customer come in. In the second, in the July audit, we oversampled the private sector and the larger private sector banks because we found the smaller public sector banks were not really, they hadn't heard of many of the financial products. There were situations where our auditor actually had to explain what ELSS was to some of the smaller banks. So we took that out and we focused more on the larger banks. So, but we found that that was it. If the person who's the bank manager is an advisor, he just asked one question, why do you want to invest? There was no further question. What did the banks recommend? Largely the default product, which is the fixed deposit. That's the product which brings in the CASA. The interesting result comes here, where we found that the private sector banks were recommending the insurance product, and the public sector banks were largely recommending the fixed deposit. So we got a clear difference in the result that insurance was being recommended by private sector. And the interesting thing to note here is that the insurance product in India carries very high front commissions. The fixed deposit doesn't have commissions, but it is part of the bank's CASA targets. When the person asked for a specific product, which is the ELSS, what happened? We found that only 14% were encouraged to buy it, 30% were discouraged, 55% had a neutral response. Where were they steered to? Public sector banks steered them to a fixed deposit. Private sector banks steered them to insurance. Why did they steer them away from other products, from ELSS to the other products? They talked about the risk. They said it's very risky. But in insurance, the product that they recommended was also market-linked, which they did not disclose. A unit-linked insurance plan is really a mutual fund with a wrap of a life insurance cover. Now, this is where the story got really interesting. So round one, where the person is only writing down, we got disclosures of returns. Okay. So they spoke about returns only 6% of the times. The reason could be that the fixed deposit rates are written everywhere in banks. So it's already disclosed and everybody sort of knows it. They didn't really talk about the costs in any of the products in round one. In round two, when they're asking questions, we got lots of disclosure. Okay, we got 100% disclosure on optimal holding period. We got lots of disclosure on early exit costs. So we're getting plenty of, people are really talking. So when we read the forms, it's very interesting to see the scribbles. They're really talking now. But were they correct? So then we went back, compared what they had recommended in terms of returns and cost, picked up every brochure, double-checked what the brochure was saying, looked at the past return rates on third-party aggregators who put these returns out on an average or for the specific product, and we found that a lot of this disclosure was incorrect. So we got, in insurance, for instance, we got 100% mismatch on what they were saying. And to be fair, a lot of times the scribbles were very involved. The guy is really trying to talk about the cost, but the insurance costs are very complicated. It's not sitting one place in the product. It is spread across the product. It is a very complicated product. So we figured that even for the person selling who wanted to do the right thing, he couldn't because it was so complicated. In the case of mutual funds, we found that a lot of the bank managers said that the product has no cost. Now, that's partially true because when you enter a mutual fund, there is no cost. It's a no-load product in India. There is no front cost. There is an expense ratio. There is expenses which are paid, which are part of the NAV, deducts the cost. That was not disclosed. So we got a result which said that disclosures are made, but they are incorrect. One of the interesting things was that the fixed deposits had a fairly large number for incorrect disclosure, 35%. And remember, the study was done in 2015 when interest rates had just fallen. So when we did the study, bank deposit rates had fallen. We felt that the bank managers had not updated themselves on their own default product, which is a fixed deposit, and were giving the higher returns which were there 6 months ago. So that's explaining that 35 number there. So in conclusion, what we found is that if we are thinking that the entire banking system is mis-selling, we haven't found evidence of that because a larger number of banks are in the public sector and they are selling the default product, the fixed deposit. So we can argue about whether that is the correct product to sell. There is a five-year fixed deposit, which is also part of the tax-saving bucket. But the problem is deep where it exists. In the private sector banks, which are selling third-party financial products like mutual funds and insurance, we found the problem very, very deep. And that is what worries us because when we make the transition towards financialization, the products which will be used will be mutual funds and insurance products. So when this transition from the fixed deposit happens to these products, we're finding that disclosures are poor, disclosures are made when asked, but they are completely incorrect. And I think I got 2 minutes to go, Susan, so I'm in time.